Hello there, welcome to Showcase. American artist Hans Slonim has painted bunnies all his life, but now he's decided to celebrate the little creature in a much bigger way.
Rabbits are a huge inspiration for artist Hans Slonim, as seen in his works at his New York studio. And the latest addition to his collection are giant bunny sculptures. This is Slonim's way of celebrating the year of the rabbit, according to the Chinese zodiac. But they won't sit in the studio forever. He'll eventually show them off in botanical gardens across the US.
It's an exaggeration of nature. It's so bigger than life when you see it against the real garden foliage that this is like, you know, an artist, my vision of what I would like nature to look like. This is mosaic. It's done with little squares of mirrored glass. It's a design that I came up with. We wanted to do things on a very large scale.
And this is how they'll look once his larger-than-life bunnies are spread across the spaces reserved for his upcoming outdoor sculpture shows. Apart from rabbits, Slonim is also a big fan of birds and butterflies. He's painted them all his life. Now he'll make other works featuring the animals to accompany his shiny bunnies.
We're going to do big, huge outdoor sculpture projects starting in Texas within a year or so. And so we've been wildly since the pandemic, where there was more time and less visits and very few people to work with. I explored all kinds of medium, like glass making, bronze, giant mosaics, there's an example back here, and designing the shows that are going to be revealed within a year or so.
Slonim still has a lot of work to do, and even when he's ready for the show, it seems his journey down the rabbit hole won't even end there.
Barbie promises to be one of the biggest box office hits of the year. Its director Greta Gerwig has spoken about the vision behind her version, which she says is a little personal.
I honestly can't believe that they let us do what we did. It's a miracle that they let us do this.
Got it.
Greta is just so joyful in her approach to filmmaking. She loves cinema, it's infectious. She makes you love it. If you work with her, if you see her films, it just was, you know, she would laugh during the takes, you know. It just was very unprecious and inclusive, and it's been an amazing ride, and it's so fun.
Here we go, Barbie day one.
Like sort of like as a bit of thing. And then hold, like after you say it, go.
It comes through is that like you love her.
Right.
You know, you do, you love her.
Noah and I wrote it together, and I didn't know that I was going to direct it. It wasn't until we had the script and I loved it that I thought, oh no, I can't bear to let anyone direct it but me. It's a spicy margarita. It's definitely, there's like a lot packed into it. And I'm so glad that you woke up thinking thoughts you didn't know you'd have.
Turn to the Barbie next to you.
There's no reason to do it if we're making a sort of commercial for it. You guys sell lots of dolls. You do not need that to sell a doll. So unless you're interested in doing it this way, well, that's fine.
Hi, Barbie!
It's Barbie. It's also an extremely personal movie for me, and it feels like a lot of things that I'm interested in, both even, you know, aesthetically from a filmmaking point of view, but also the ideas in it and kind of the emotions of it and the characters and how what we're exploring and how we're looking at it.
Netflix has set a hand in ushering in the binge-watching age, and among the royalty of that tradition is The Witcher. But with the show's third season, the streaming company has decided to change its release strategy. Let's now see why that could be a vital move.
The dangers we've seen foretell an even more menacing future. For the first time, I understand real fear.
The Witcher is Netflix's own entry into the race among fantasy TV shows. It's based on the New York Times best-selling books of the same name. That gives the series both literary cred and a fan following. So it's no surprise that it has enjoyed the title of most popular show on the platform. And obviously, fanfare has also built up for the third season. This time, we find Geralt bent on protecting his recently united family from threats. He takes Ciri into hiding, while the mages and the beasts of the continent try to find her.
Everything that's happening, it's all connected.
Those involved in the show say season 3 is when everything changes in the story. But viewers who want to know how that happens will have to wait. Because interestingly, Netflix decided to split The Witcher's latest season into 2 volumes. And that's a major change in strategy. Normally, the company releases all episodes of its shows at once, and people often go through them in one sitting. This was vital in the creation of the binge-watching culture. So splitting a season into 2 halves is an unexpected choice. The producers say in the world of streaming services, there are no cliffhangers that could take viewers to the edge, and they essentially wanted to ante up the anticipation for the next episode.
Cirilla of Sintra. Alone at last. Well, not quite. I've brought more friends this time.
Given that serials have been based on cliffhangers since the 1910s, that makes sense.
I like my odds.
I like our odds better!
But some subscribers have already jumped ship and left Netflix. In Spain alone, the company lost almost 1 million viewers after ending its account sharing. So this new release strategy could help those who are left with nothing to do after binging through a whole season in just one go.
The elves came for Ciri.
As for Netflix, which has perhaps changed our viewing habits forever, it's more a case of going back to basics.
Black Swan is not your typical K-pop group anymore, and it's recently released a new single and music video since transforming into an all-foreigner band.
Karma is Black Swan's latest song. Its music video was shot in India, which is also where one of its newer group members, Sriya, is from. She joined Black Swan last year along with Gabby, who's from Brazil. As for the other two members, Fatou is Senegalese-Belgian, while Navi is from the US. This update came after 2 of its Korean members left, making the K-pop group an all-foreigner band. The girls didn't undergo the strict training that many Korean idols go through before they debut, but they all have a background in either dancing or musical theatre. As for Fatou, the band's de facto leader, the most challenging part was conquering the language barrier.
Challenges for me would be just being away from home, and at the beginning also the language and the culture difference. As for being one of the few K-pop idol, like black K-pop idols, there's a bit of a heavy weight with that, but I just try not to really think about the weight of that. But I'm just really grateful and thankful that I get to be able to inspire like other people.
As for the strict beauty standards to which K-pop idols generally have to adhere, Gabby says that's not an issue either.
But we try to not think that much about that because, like, everyone has their own, like, beauty, and, like, we are here to, like, represent someone else, someone that also wants to, like, become a K-pop star.
That approach might give hope to the many Korean pop fans who want to be more than just that. And Fatou's message to them is simple: believe in yourself.
Passion, love, and pain come together at a digital exhibit depicting the life and work of Frida Kahlo. The display in the Colombian capital combines technology and art, allowing visitors to explore Kahlo's legacy through motion and special effects.
Following a massive wave of success in many countries, the highly anticipated exhibition, Life and Work of Frida Kahlo, is now on display in Bogota's Maloca City Hall. Having captivated viewers with its exquisite sensorial spectacle, the exhibition unveils the universe of Kahlo, using her diary as a common thread.
This exhibition allows you to feel that you are inside Frida's head. It is almost as if it were a first-person creation. We have worked with elements such as her diary. She wrote it during the last 10 years of her life, and it was never intended to be published. It is pure honesty. We also complete it with letters, so that the audiovisual production is generated almost as if you were inside her head.
The artist endured many hardships that significantly impacted her art. She embarked on her painting journey while recovering from a bus accident, which relates most of her work to physical suffering. Kahlo's marriage to the famed muralist Diego Rivera was fraught with infidelities and ultimately ended in divorce. The emotional pain she suffered during that relationship also became a major theme in her paintings.
The way in which we tell this exhibition is made up of different galleries that prepare the user to understand a little more who Frida was. You can already be a fan of her work but not know her as much as an artist. So the rooms allow you to understand a little more who she was. In this immersive room, we have a 36-minute audiovisual production in which we help the user to understand Frida Kahlo as a woman.
The exhibit will be on display to offer visitors a closer look at Kahlo's vibrant universe until September 12th.
Straight Future is one of the biggest Hollywood couplings on screen. It's also regarded the best Alfred Hitchcock-esque film, not directed by the master of suspense himself. But The Future also found itself at the center of one of the strangest and most intriguing Hollywood stories. And in our movie almanac, Alijon explains how this acclaimed thriller also had a tangled relationship with U.S. copyright laws.
Not a very large turnout, is it? Didn't Charles have any friends? Don't ask me, I'm only the widow.
In Charade, a woman is chased around by criminals who are after the fortune of her dead husband, whom she was planning to divorce. But as the bad guys corner her, a man keeps helping her out each time. The woman is played by Audrey Hepburn, and her protector, none other than Cary Grant.
A man tried to kill me! Crooked?
Crooked? I just think you'd be glad to find out I'm not crooked.
As you can see, it has all the makings of a classic. The Guardian says at a time when television was on the rise, and in the aftermath of the Kennedy assassination, the flick provided one last gleam of a golden age Hollywood.
The lunch hour. Probably worked it out in advance. Found an office usually left open and just moved in for the time you were here.
Then how do I know this is your office?
Other reviews called it a delightful romp, with great chemistry between the leads. It also landed at the top 10 of the highest grossing movies of 1963. And little wonder, given its thriller aspect and star power.
Brian Crookshank. Serves me right if I get stuck with that one.
Well, who asked you to get stuck with any of them? Come on.
Is there a Mrs. Crookshank?
But what mightn't make sense is that the day it was released in cinemas by Universal Pictures, Charade also fell into the public domain.
Game is over, Mrs. Lampett.
And because of that, bootleg copies of the movie popped up in VHS and other home media entertainment. That is the common fate of films that fall into the public domain one way or another. But in Charade's case, how can that happen, you might ask?
Oh, I'm so hungry, I could faint. And I've gotten your suit all wet.
That's all right, it's a drip dry.
Well, the film does include a notice that was meant to show it's under copyright. But apparently, someone forgot to add the copyright symbol. Before the 1970s, copyright was a different kind of thing in America. The marking that Universal forgot to add was necessary for a movie to be protected by law. But the film and its soundtrack are held to different accounts. For those who enjoy the cool Henry Mancini score, they still can't use it outside the context of the film, because the composition is still under copyright.
He'll kill me.
Oh, don't take it seriously. He's just trying to frighten you. My mother, she lives in Detroit. You'd like her. She'd like you, too. Come on, give me those stamps.
Not until you prove to me that you're really Brian Crookshank.
By being at the center of such a bizarre debacle, Charade not only takes its place in history as one of the last examples of Golden Age Hollywood storytelling, but also becomes a cautionary tale about the importance of fine prints.
Oh, I love you, Adam, Alex, Peter, Brian, whatever your name is.
When you think of constant contenders for the top of the box office, one juggernaut that comes to mind is Transformers. But the franchise's origins is what sets it apart from the rest of the competition. And the series's latest entry seems to go back to those roots.
For centuries, our kind has stayed hidden on Earth. But darkness has found us again.
Rise of the Beasts finds Autobots fight a planet-eating being. In that battle, they are joined by the Maximals, a breed of robots that, instead of turning into vehicles, have animalistic features. The movie belongs to what the media calls the 400 Club, for making more than $400 million. Compared to the Michael Bay-directed Transformers, it may not be big money.
I'm nobody. I ain't even seen nothing. I'm not even seeing anything right now.
But this incarnation still has a trump card up its sleeve. Fan service.
This is not our war.
See, a good number of Hollywood properties are based on comic books. But Transformers' origins lie in a much different medium. The series started life as a toy line in 1984. To popularize it among kids, a comic and a cartoon were also developed.
Everything you cared for will be consumed.
Future incarnations of the property went for different designs. But the first generation look is what a good percentage of the fandom identifies the franchise with. When the live-action movies started in the 2000s, director Bay's visualization divided fans because it steered away from first-generation principles. Nevertheless, his vision of the robots became the aesthetic of the movies until this day. But now with Rise of the Beasts, the series makes a dramatic change in that department. The film goes back to the original Generation 1 designs, and that should make fans happy. Cult characters from the franchise's vaults are also brought back. The Maximals first appeared in the Transformers universe during the 1990s. And even though the classic villains, the Decepticons, are missing in action, the film does bring back a long-forgotten bad guy, Unicron, a character that made its debut in the first feature-length animated feature in 1986. It's not easy to predict if all this fan service will pay off for the studio in the long run. But the fact that a toy line from nearly 40 years ago still exists as a box office contender may offer a hint. Together. Let's get it.
It's often said that children not only perceive things differently from adults, but even from one another. And that's what French artist Saipe has tried to capture. He has used the slopes of a village in Switzerland to paint two frescoes of children, sketching how they see the vast world around them.
These are two children, each drawing what they see from their point of view. What's funny is that the children are on different altitudes, so are drawing different things, and I call these frescoes The Sun Meets with the Moon. And another level of interpreting it is that even at different altitudes, the two worlds they are drawing complement each other.
Form de complémentarité.
Another exhibition is marking the 50th anniversary of Pablo Picasso's death. Prado Museum in Madrid has a new show, but this one reveals Picasso's fascination with El Greco.
Picasso, El Greco, an analytical cubism exhibition at Madrid's Prado Museum looks at the influence of El Greco on Pablo Picasso's work. It compares a dozen of Picasso's paintings with those by El Greco in terms of color, brush strokes, and composition.
Well, this exhibition is our contribution to the 50th anniversary of Picasso's death, and we have done so with a very precise, very specific theme, which is the relationship or the inspiration that Picasso may have found in El Greco for what was his greatest contribution, probably the most revolutionary to the history of painting, which is analytical cubism.
The exhibition's curator, Carmen Jimenez, says the first cubist artist was in fact El Greco, and his techniques are what profoundly influenced Picasso's work.
This exhibition is essential. Let's say it's the cubism that originated with El Greco, especially from his last period. Throughout El Greco's career, one can also see the influence he could have had on cubism. But above all, it's in The Last Apostles where El Greco felt free and really began to do what Pacheco called the cruel smudges, which are what inspired Picasso, who came here as a student at the Academy of Fine Arts. And during the time he spent in the Prado, he was fascinated by El Greco.
Another important connection explored is between Picasso and the Prado Museum. He was appointed director of the institution in 1936, and the exhibition also presents some relevant documents from that time.
This exhibition at the Prado Museum is of exceptional importance because Picasso was the director of the museum during the Civil War. That means that there is a very particular link. Apart from the fact that Picasso visited this museum practically from the time he was a child.
Those visits to the museum planted the first seeds that grew into Picasso's easily recognized style.
The first time he comes to the Prado, he's fascinated by Velázquez. The second time he comes to the Prado, he's fascinated by El Greco. He discovers El Greco. And it's the beginning of Cubism. Let's say El Greco is the one who made Picasso see the double dimensionality. And so we can say that he was fundamental in the conception of Cubism.
And despite the more than 300 years that separate the two masters, the dialogue between their works speaks volumes.
That's it for this episode of Showcase. I'm Esra Drust from me and the whole team here in Istanbul. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.